Max Trinity's Metaphysics for Suicide Prevention, Part 8, The Paradoxical Task. Boundaries are the playthings of the boundless. An example of a classic paradoxical question is this. If God can do anything, can he create a rock that's too heavy for him to lift? If it seems like a riddle, that's because it is. If you approach it from a dualistic, one-dimensional, linear orientation, it will appear unsolvable. If you approach it from a multidimensional, nonlinear orientation, you can find many resolutions for this conundrum. The solutions lie in the all-inclusive perspective of comfortable paradox. Comfortable paradox is the state of being able to admit and integrate seemingly opposed scenarios like the one above, and to feel natural, at ease, curiously aroused, and comfortable with it. When we can acknowledge paradox with a grin of mischievous knowing, that signals directly that we are becoming more comfortable in our multi-domain existence. It means we are beginning to fill in the spaces we expanded for our spirit through our direct first-hand experiences. We live in paradox, always. We don't sense this in our less expanded states because the conundrum of it is overwhelming. It can literally hurt to think about paradox. Yet, it is the wider context of our very existence. Paradox is all-inclusive. It can only be seen through win-win, symbiotic, and flexible perspectives. Through our real-time experiences, we gain skill in discerning symbiotic exchanges, in creating win-win scenarios, and in having enough psychological flexibility to include virtually everything. As we reflect on our own experiences, we can see how we have always been growing and expanding in these skills of discerning, flexibility, and creativity of thought. The reach of our focus has naturally expanded to include more and more. This is how our minds and personalities develop and grow. We essentially grow our souls through the natural development of our individual personality that occurs with expanding focus. This growth isn't something that can be forced. It can only be noticed. Just like you can't force pubic hair to grow, it just shows up, and it's a sign of natural human development. So, when you begin to notice the so obvious paradoxical state of affairs and you are comfortable in it and even mildly amused by it, that's a sign of your psychological and spiritual development. It's a sign that you are transitioning into early adulthood, adepthood, surferhood. It's a true benchmark of expanded awareness, and it releases all that pressure that built up from trying to fit everything into the perspective of duality. You can still use duality as a creative view to generate contrast and win-lose scenarios, but in actuality, being able to breathe the free air of the all-inclusive and to bounce around where there's room for any association is far too fun and eclipses duality in potential because you don't have to choose between this or that anymore. You get to choose this and that and experience all of it. Let it be a sign to you when you begin to freely notice the ironies, the natural paradoxical aspects of your everyday environment. This means you are essentially growing up. A paradox to play with. Here's a paradox that's close to home. What the hands can create, they can never hold. This paradox takes us into the big picture view of our life as a whole. When you examine your life, you'll see that all the food, all the arts and crafts, all the money, all the gestures, music, and caressing that came from your hands can never be held in your hands. We humans make buildings and bridges and art and greetings and comfort with our hands. We create stories and make paper and ink and books, and then those stories live outside of our hands. We steer and mold and create and destroy with our hands, and sometimes it's as if these hands of ours have a life of their own, the secret life of hands. Yeah, I've always suspected this. Watch now what's happening to your perspective. It's transforming and turning your sight around corners that aren't common in your daily routine focus. One of the gems in this paradox is that it reveals our flowing nature. Our hands aren't really holders so much as they are molders, directors, transmitters, receivers, and channels. Materials flow through our hands. We transmit pain, pleasure, affection, comfort, and love through our hands. We receive materials, sensations, and tools into our hands and generate endless creations by directing the order and organization of materials, by directing the use of tools and machines, and by directing toward intended results, destinations, and ideas. If you take this little mind walk to the secret life of your hands, you'll simultaneously see that you yourself are some type of time channel, that time and materials flow through you to flesh out your dreams and stories. You know, we try so hard to hold on to things, to hold on to people, to hold on to life and love and our sense of free-spiritedness, but we just never can. Things are always changing, and as we can see here, our hands are telling us that holding is always temporary. We suffer a lot of heartache when we feel life stripping us from the things, the ones we hold most dear, when meanings fall away and old friends slip away, and everything kind of seems to go away. It can be hurtful, sad, and feels melancholy just to think it. But maybe it's painful because we have the wrong idea about ourselves. Maybe we can let go of the perspective of holding and see what is open to us in the perspective of flowing. If you can see your flowing nature, then your temporary handling of things transmutes into a magical touch. When you channel energy, material, and ideas, they flow through you and make direct contact with the unique energy configuration that is your personality. The instant that contact is made, your attention becomes part of the flowing material, and the pattern of that flow and the designs flowing through become a part of you. You don't have to hold something for it to be a part of you. Your flowing together with it shows that it has always been and will forever be a part of you. We only lose when we believe that holding is how we have something in our world or keep someone in our life. When we realize that we are part of every story that we've flowed through and that those stories are indelibly a part of us, then we begin to adjust to our eternal nature. Once a story is told, it can never be untold. Our stories are forever aspects of our flowing nature. We are dwelling in our temporary aspects when we attempt to hold on to anything. Our holding is really only a brief touching. Our flowing is forever. Turn your attention to the emergent newness of all that you're flowing with. Think now of the people you love the most. The forever perspective lies in their continuous flow with you. We all naturally assimilate parts of each other's spirit when we flow beside each other in life streams. We take on each other's ideas, mannerisms, humor, perspectives, entertainments, adventures, expressions, and bits of each other's style. This is how we merge and become a part of each other. From the moment we met, we changed each other's flow and all our flowing together shifts and shapes our shared adventure. That shifting and shaping and flowing is non-physical. It's our meta nature and can never really end or die. The flowing perspective shows us that what we are can't be lost or taken away. If you will just focus on the winding curves of your relationship with any one person that you love, just follow the reliably unpredictable path you've taken together, and then look up from that view very slowly, and you'll see that no matter the physical circumstance, your flow with this person continues. You'll always be flowing together. You continue together in the flow. You are never apart in that wonderful present moment, all-reaching perspective. Be there in that always flowing motion, and you lose your desire to hold. And in losing that desire, you never lose again. Wherever and whatever you give the slightest bit of passing attention to is affected by you, and you by it. Think now of the richness and far-reaching threads woven between hearts bound together through love and friendship. Think how deep the flow is that continuously emerges through the touch of one that loves you and that you love. You know intuitively that that deep flow relating and intimate knowing can never be held on to. That's a delusion of the physical illusion. It is. Flow with the continuous influence and affection that is born in every moment of relating. Honor the quirks and eccentricities that you've added to your style because you merged with your buddy. If you laugh like them, witness it and acknowledge it. If they motivated you to see in a different way, witness that and acknowledge that you got that from your contact with your special friend. Admit and honor how much you restructured your own point of view because you fell in love and a new you emerged in the process. The flow is where you get to keep your experiences, and when you shift into the deeper perspective of reflection, you can have living holographic experiences of your shared stories. In this living holographic reflection, you flow in a stream within a stream. Your influence continues and is always mutual. What you give and receive in relating can never be lost or taken away from you. We cannot hold our loves in our hands, but we can always be beside them in the flow, and we can keep them in our hearts as the soulmates of our forever stories. Be of good cheer, friends, because no one and nothing is ever really lost. So we see that our hands can never hold all that they can create. We see that we have this flowing aspect, and it offers us a way to our forever paths and our own infinite reach. In our so-called limited mortal capacity, we are able to create things too heavy for us to lift. This reflects back to that question. If God can do anything, can he create a rock too heavy for him to lift? If we can do it, I'm pretty sure God can. So the answer from the paradoxical view is yes. The stripped down question is this. Can the infinite generate finite versions of itself? Wouldn't those versions still be essentially infinite in nature, since they're versions of the infinite and generating from the infinite? Yes, the finite versions would be infinite, but behave within a set of boundaries that made them appear finite. One of these versions would be unable to lift certain rocks, so the infinite would have the experience of not being able to lift a part of itself because the rock too would essentially be a part of the infinite. This perspective reveals that if we find ourselves operating from a sense of limitation, then we're operating on appearances. Appearances are not to be underestimated here. Holograms and virtual environments are appearances that are real enough to give us very real first-hand experiences. If a holographic dragon suddenly appeared in front of you, every feeling you had in reaction to it would be real enough, all right. Physical life is often referred to in philosophical terms as a dream, an illusion, and in more recent times, a hologram and a virtual reality of some sort, a game for the gods or a vision that universe is dreaming. There's a really cool ancient belief that the first time God ever thought of you, she had a distinct and profound feeling she'd never felt before. That feeling, that unique vibration of you, is said to be your true name, the name of your eternal self. It's what spiritual traditions refer to as the secret name, the hidden name, or the new name. It's secret and hidden because it's not a word that can be spoken. It's a feeling and vibration that emerged in the formation of your individual self. This feeling is the pure vibration of your unique energy configuration, the sound your soul makes. So it's secret and hidden because it's a frequency that can only be made by you and God. It's called the new name because it's what God felt the first time she thought of you, the vibration she emanated in the conception of your very being. Once upon a time of no time, God had an epiphany, and that epiphany was you, and in that instant, everything is new. That's why it's called your new name. It is, in fact, your ancient name, and that brings this paradox full spiral. God, the universe, all that is forever and always having new ideas, breathing life into them and fleshing them out, and bounded in specific expressions. These expressions take on their own life and through eons of expanding experience reach their own infinite expanded state and sit with the gods in perfect comfort and belonging. The infinite springs off into infinite sparks that flame and surge and stretch till they reunite with their own infinite nature and are ever renewed and ever unchanging. In the same instant. To see this aspect of yourself, to experience your own originating nature, is cosmic awareness. That's your surfer self peering through your mortal view of it. That's your surfer looking at itself through your eyes. Yeah, it's called cosmic for that reason. Avoiding the memory wipe. Part of what paradoxical perspectives do for us is to acquaint our minds with our multiple incarnation nature. The term reincarnation is a misnomer. Reincarnation implies a linear process, one lifetime occurring after another in a sequence. That notion is self-obsoleting because multiple incarnation is a simultaneous state, not a linear one. The term multiple incarnation is more expansive and fits our eternal nature rather than our limited linear nature. It also allows for the existence of parallel dimensions, infinite probabilities, and many worlds at once. This brings some calm to the current crises plaguing physics and cosmology. The fields of physics and cosmology are just sticking their toes in the waters of infinite unbound nature, and that's a whole book in itself. Read Rupert Sheldrake's Science Set Free, and you'll get a good overview on the current evolution occurring in these fields of science. So multiple incarnations at once. When coming from our single incarnation dualistic view, we can see that it's quite a transition to become aware of multiple personal incarnations happening all at the same time. How in the hell does that work? Is the question that comes to my mind. It's a good question. Well, our expanded experience just in outlining this quest has revealed that our focus of attention has multi-domain qualities and can include more than a linear stream of thoughts, one thought nugget at a time. At some point, we become aware of our expanded focus, and even that realization itself expands the focus even further. It's exactly like getting to a mountain peak and seeing a higher peak in the distance. The higher peak was out of your sight until your view got broader and your reach expanded. That's all good, but again, how exactly is this happening? This conditioning of the focus from linear to nonlinear capacities. In the linear view, everything happens in a sequence of steps, one after another, with a particular starting point and a particular ending. In the nonlinear view, all the steps are present at once, and the movement is not sequential. Endings and beginnings do not apply so much either. It's an all-at-once kind of orientation. It's like making a cake versus having the recipe for the cake. In order to bake the cake, the recipe must be followed in a linear manner with steps proceeding in a particular order. The end result is a cake. The recipe itself is the nonlinear expression of the cake. The recipe is the design aspect, the design state of the cake. In the recipe, all the steps are present at once, and any step or ingredient can be referred to in any order. The recipe is a set of non-physical boundaries for the cake. The function of the recipe is to describe, define, and direct the merging elements from which a cake will result. The cake recipe will always describe the emergence of cake. That's the truth of the recipe. It persistently results in a physical cake when followed in the physical realm. So, in our linear perspective, we have a physical experience of making and eating and digesting and assimilating and shedding cake, all in that sequence. In our nonlinear experience, we have the non-physical experience of pattern recognition and pattern initiation. We also have the non-physical experience of design interaction, our design, interacting with the cake design. Our physical cake making adds to our overall cake experience, and we may even find ourselves experimenting with our own recipes, our own designs. So there's this constant interplay between our nonlinear cake design experiences and our linear cake production experiences. It's amazing how unamazed we are at our own multi-level experiences. We think of making a cake as such a simple notion when, if we look closer, it holds some of the very keys to moving from reincarnational perspectives to our simultaneous multiple incarnational views. And we do so much more than make cakes. We as humans are immersed in so many activities in the linear sense that at any given moment, we're in the beginning, middle, and end of multiple events, scenarios, cycles, and processes all at once. If you really reflect on it, it's bloody astonishing that we're not completely overwhelmed and stunned just upon waking up. Each action we're engaged in brings us into direct contact with the design nature, the recipe for that action. From here, we can see that we are constantly and seamlessly engaging with the non-physical, non-linear design aspects of virtually everything. Yet, we're not overwhelmed. In fact, we can even get bored in this miraculous carnival of paradoxical all-inclusiveness and frequently seek more challenging experience. We're clearly more awesome than we're admitting. Somehow, we're not even noticing it. Hence, the importance of intentional noticing. In our real-time human stories, we can use our expanded skills of discerning the infinite and creating with design and intention. Instead of looking at our physical incarnations as linear events in which we move from one life to another, we can view our incarnations in terms of desired kinds of experience, in which we use our multiple lifetimes to expand qualities of existence. through our direct experimenting with different designs, different kinds of scenarios, qualities, and meanings, we expand our experiences and add to the reach of our personal expression so we can do more. In this nonlinear state of expanding, different qualities, our body, mind, and soul, are in perfect concert, not missing a beat in the interplay between them. In this interplay, our overall experience naturally develops, matures, and transforms. The simplest way to put this is in this little soundbite. Linear activity is about going from here to there. Nonlinear activity is about going from this to that. To go from here to there, from one location to another, involves travel over distance, which employs linear time and linear thought. In our non-linear existence, we are moving between qualities of existence, not locations. In fact, to experience different qualities of being, we need not travel any distance or take any time at all. You can sit in one spot and feel excited and then feel distracted, and feel lighthearted and then highly focused. These qualities of existence are experienced simply by giving attention to them. We don't have to travel to some place called humor and then to another place called excitement, or wait for time to pass to feel any feeling or experience any particular quality of life. Qualities and feelings are instantaneously experienced just by focusing on them. In reality, we experience many overlapping qualities of existence simultaneously, of course. We can shift our focus from one to another without moving. We can shift between qualities without disrupting or diminishing other qualities. Moving from this quality to that quality is the constant nonlinear activity of our non-physical aspects and our nonlinear focus. We use the same capacity to begin to become more aware of our multiple incarnations. In the linear orientation, we have to experience the dying and being reborn repeatedly model of reincarnation. We must die and be reborn only to forget the previous life, like a memory wipe. It's not to torture or hurt us in any way. Having this parameter of forgetting other lives allows us to focus exclusively on our primary incarnation and the personality and story we're creating with this life. Until our capacity to focus develops to the point of ease with multiple domain experiences, we will continue in the perspective of one life after another. As we develop our focus and expand through experience, we start to have increasing flashes and overlaps with other aspects of ourselves, other incarnations. We begin to recognize things in places outside our firsthand experiences. We have knowledge of serendipitous aid from other dimensions, and we feel compelled to express things that are not really consistent with our own personality. These experiences can be as mundane as having a sudden strange craving or a random impulse, or they can be quite dramatic. When a particularly strong personality encounters a less developed personality, the less developed personality can be overshadowed. This can take on the appearance of borderline personality disorder, a sense of fakeness in self-expression, and an underexpression of genuine personal style. It can be really unsettling. These are just some of the challenges when we start to come into realization of our simultaneous incarnations. It can make you feel pretty crazy and pretty disingenuous at times. Just know it's part of adjusting to a broader view, and there are ways you can approach these changes so that it can go a lot smoother. One way is to approach your multi-incarnational self through this notion of qualities of existence. For instance, say in this life you're a female who has opted to have no children, and you own a vineyard in Tuscany. You have a lot of friends, and you've been lucky in love, but you mostly enjoy being single, being solitary, You have a strong sense of self and a deep appreciation for your own life. Your days include working in the vineyard, simple meals, the companionship of two elderly golden retrievers, and you dabble in the arts. You're a retired dancer who likes to write a bit of poetry, occasionally paint, and strum on the guitar a little. You're very reflective and generally very satisfied and content with your life. You lost the lower part of your left leg in a car accident. That's what ended the dancing. And your mama died when you were only 12, so you're well acquainted with the pain of suffering and loss. But you've spent your life always bending toward the light of appreciation. I'm lucky, you say. I am surely one of the fortunate souls in this world. Instead of viewing this as a life in a string of mostly forgotten lives, you look at it in a non-linear way. You look for the qualities that are being experienced and valued in the life story. In this case, we can see that we're exploring the qualities of independence, solitude, and appreciation. We're exploring the female package and what that's like. And we are very earthy, living in a beautiful environment and working with the land and seasons. We dabble in some arts, but dancing held our passion more than any. We're focused on the qualities of creativity, appreciation, and simple enjoyment. Our overall sense is that life is good. Once you've identified the qualities of existence you're fleshing out in your story, you then use them like a search term. If you're focused on making music, for instance, it's a direct conduit to any incarnation of your soul that plays music, aspires to play, or has a deep appreciation and passion for listening to music. The musical moments, qualities, and expressions of your life are connections between you and your other incarnations. When we're involved in the activities that bring out these musical qualities, we set ourselves up to intersect other incarnations of ourselves that are engaged in these same qualities. When we're in love with someone, there are other incarnations of our couple selves experiencing their love stories concurrently. It only makes sense that soulmates would be sharing multiple life stories and multiple incarnations together. Our four-legger friends are most likely our four-legger friends in other times and places, so those connecting moments can occur with our beloved pets too. The point is this: you're not trying to connect with your other incarnations through past timelines or storylines or past life regression sessions. Instead, you're naturally connecting through the qualities of existence, experience, and identity that are the major themes in your life right now. It doesn't always mean that your other incarnations are having the exact same experiences. See, if you're experiencing a lot of bad relationships, there are likely other incarnations of you that are having very good relationships, maybe even with the same other person. It's more that these incarnations of you are sharing and making the quality of relationship one of the major themes of life, giving it a great deal of meaning in the personal story. You can see that it's a completely different approach to life to focus on the non-linear aspects rather than the linear unfoldment. They're both occurring at once, and one doesn't cancel out the other. The linear and non-linear views actually support and perpetuate each other. We're not attempting to eliminate the linear view, we're just expanding on it. Like all the other developments that naturally occur with expanding consciousness, there's no need to try to force the qualitative view of multiple incarnations. It just starts to happen that way. It's how the experience of transitioning into multidimensional reach naturally occurs. When you start remembering your past lives, it's the beginning of this emerging multiple access focus. If you don't at least feel the hint of this yet, you will. Using paradox to heal. At the onset of adolescence, we're exposed to this vast and unbelievable expression of paradox. We start to notice right away that the adults around us seem to be living in ways that don't really square with what they claim to believe or what they've taught us as children. We see the hypocrisy of the so-called adults. It's common to lose some regard for grown-ups and actually come to see our elders as ignorant to what's really happening in the world. We become quite arrogant in our awakening to reality. Ah, yes, adolescent arrogance. So much fun. Well, look, Junior, just dial that judgmental hypocrisy shit back a little. A, you're supposed to come to see that flawed nature of your elders so that you will find your own way and pierce the veil of outside authority. You need to keep in mind your elders have made this same journey. You can also allow this newfound scope of vision to shed light on the fact that the elders are just people. They're not the heroic, godlike figures you thought they were in your childhood view. They, like you, are making it up as they go and flying by the seat of their pants. No one, young or old, has it all figured out. No one. And B, no one walks their talk 100% of the time. We're not machines. We're free agents, and that automatically includes a measure of unpredictability and unreliability. Also, with added experience, our talk will change, and there will be a transition from the old way to the new. At different points and for different reasons, our actions will be inconsistent with our talk. Thank goodness for hypocrisy, or we'd just be robots stuck in limited programs. But we're not. We're free-ranging, roving, ever-expanding creatures who cannot ever be pinned down to one idea. Sometimes we even scare ourselves with our own wild and free nature. Actually, most of the time we're afraid of our wildness because we're afraid we'll do harm or be too hard to be close to if we embrace it. We tame ourselves and even attempt to domesticate ourselves by squishing our free-willing personalities into tight, pre-packaged ideas of what's acceptable. We try to fit our gigantic nature into tight little molds of appropriateness, and we make ourselves bloomin' nuts in the process. It's because we fear our free nature. We fear our wild side. We fear that our natural free impulses will be to do harm. In our reality, it's actually the repressing of all this free energy that results in the warpage of violence and intentional ruin. We have to and will eventually expand to the point of no longer fearing and repressing our free nature. In that phase, we experience a great deal of healing. The expansive reach of living in harmony with our free impulses will remove the built-up pressure and inflammation caused by repression. The equanimity of trusting and loving our free nature is the most liberating and simultaneously calming viewpoint we can ever arrive to. It might be the main motivation for taking on these physical adventures in the first place. It's not just our hearts and minds that experience these healing realizations. The body is healed in the same instant that you fully realize that you have very real multidimensional reach. Having conscious multidimensional access gives you all kinds of pathways for healing the physical body of virtually anything. If you have an incurable disease or suffer from chronic physical pain or any physical malady, you can heal yourself through the paradoxical orientation. The paradoxical orientation gives you access to your other incarnations, many of whom do not have your condition or have healed themselves of it. It's a matter of probable selves being related to you through this theme of physical suffering. Physical suffering is a quality of existence. Remember, we access our other incarnations through qualities of existence that are the major themes in our story. If you have chronic pain, there are other incarnations of you that are dealing directly with that quality. Some may be dealing with it from the healing perspective. You have direct access to these healers who are sharing in your soul existence. Direct access. If your style is prayer, you can use prayer to connect with your other selves that have ready solutions, and you can be healed just through that contact. From the outside, it would appear to be a faith healing or spontaneous remission. From the inside, it would be a consciously acknowledged contact with another incarnation of you. You can acknowledge your multidimensional existence and simply ask your expanded sense of self for help. Next thing you know, you'll cross paths with a healer who knows how to cure exactly what you have, or your own research will turn up a process or herb or method that brings relief to your symptoms. Being in chronic physical pain or having a chronic malady concentrates your focus of attention on that aspect of your life. The high focus can actually increase the pain, suffering, and damage. Your condition puts you in a position of having to be able to train your focus in soothing and relieving perspectives even while the pain is happening. If you use the condition to maintain a victim status, then you'll continue to suffer and possibly even die from it. You have to find your own way to experience the pain without making yourself a victim of it. People do this all the time. Many people live with pain, but don't let it be the center of their identity, and they experience less suffering. In the paradoxical view, since your physical body is literally grabbing your focus of attention, it's a signal to focus less on the body and its pain and more on the non-physical aspects of your life. That's why so many spiritual folks voice humble appreciation for their physical challenges. They've found a genuine way to make it work for them in the context of their story and personal development. Again, if you suffer from a chronic condition of pain, you can use it to form any meaning you choose. In those meanings, you'll either suffer more or suffer less. You have every opportunity to heal or to master your pain. Allow your other selves, the other incarnations of you that most assuredly exist, to assist you. In that action, you'll gain a lot more than liberation from pain. You'll break the elusive physical boundaries and pierce the veil of separateness that binds you to the death and rebirth cycles of linear reincarnation. Can you do that? Of course you can. You would not be reading these words were it otherwise. Another aspect of this physical challenge is that you can be the multidimensional healer. If you find a way to heal yourself, then you can consciously extend that healing wave of power to any incarnation of yourself that may be in need of relief. Simply by uttering the words and believing them, you make it so. And if you watch for them, you'll be given undeniable signs that the multidimensional healing has in fact taken place. This is what can be described as a win-win symbiotic relationship that you have with your other selves. Right now, we're living in a competition, win-lose, parasitic context here on Earth, but that orientation is coming to a natural close. You can hear it on the wind and witness it in the emerging language of cooperation, co-creation, and community. This is part of the awakening. It's not hard to see that the competitive win-lose parasitic scenarios naturally lend themselves to pain. The pain of focused struggle, the pain of loss and its accompanying sense of inadequacy, and the pain of being sucked on by some vampiric energy, or the pain of being parasitic yourself and dependent on diminishing the energy of others in order to survive. Ugh, so gross. It's a necessary phase, though, of development, this competition-driven context, but it's not meant to last forever. We're meant to use it to sharpen our skills, to use our existence as something to refine our personalities and identities with. We do this with comparison, and those we compete with are those we feel are holding some higher skill or standard that we aspire to. Our competitors are some of our best self-reflectors and teachers. We learn a lot in competition, and we even learn a lot from losing. What we learn is necessary and invaluable to the growth of our soul. But we're also meant to move on from those qualities and to grow into the more expanded reach of cooperation. Our parasitic nature also has a natural completion because it symbolizes our immaturity and continued aspects of dependence on something outside of ourselves. When we expand to the point of maturity, to genuine adulthood, we will no longer be dependent in our existence. We will be co-creators with life, all-inclusive and equal to all that exists. Our hearts will naturally generate win-win scenarios, and our creations will be multiplied by our conscious and intentional, multidimensional infinite reach. That's where we're headed, folks. That's our natural progression. Piercing the veils. The veil is thinning. There aren't many people who don't have some notion of what that phrase means. We've even heard it put more specifically as the veil of forgetfulness, or the veil between the living and the dead, is thinning. There's a deep sense that quickens at the onset of adolescence, a sense that some vital key, some essential understanding of our own existence is missing. It's this sense that prompts the notion of a veil of forgetting, a sort of species-wide amnesia that cuts us off from crucial self-knowledge. It's also this sense that fuels the quest for finding meaning, for crafting our own identity and our own fleshed-out sense of individual expression. We also experience such a stark separation from our loved ones at the time of physical death that we perceive yet another veil to crucial aspects of our own existence. The death of the physical body brings about the most intense experience of finality that we could ever imagine. It's devastating. It conjures up feelings of annihilation and gaping sorrow. Our grieving is directly proportionate to our feelings of loss and ultimate separation. This raw sense of separation and finality at the point of physical death is one of the most challenging aspects of physical life in linear narratives that we ever experience. And I'm including all of creation in that statement. I believe that we choose these harrowing experiences to expand our reach of compassion, consideration, cooperation, and co-creation. It makes sense that if we are going to create in ever-expanding realms of influence, then we must have the expanded capacity to deeply consider the orientation of all those who we would create with. We must temper our ambitions to create with compassion for our creations and the experiences generated by them. As we expand into more cooperative adventures, our direct first-hand experiences with death, with loss, and ultimate finality will equip us with the necessary purity of heart to take our mutual gain to the next level. The veil of physical death is the seal on the crucible of our personal purification. Inside the crucible, we feel the fire of consuming sorrow. We feel the isolation of our individualized elements. We experience directly the transformation of our annihilated dreams, and we know we are fully transmuted when we break through the seal of physical death and it no longer holds sway in our journeys. That transmutation is alchemy, and we're born to it genetically, in spirit, in story, and in our natural unfolding through phases of ever-increasing realizations and reach. It's our personal focus of attention that gets born into the physical realms, that undergoes transformation and transmutation, and transcends the veils of forgetting and death and rebirth and re-death and rebirth and more dying and so on. The focus remains constant, vital and fully aware throughout every phase of development, and shows itself to be core to our cosmic awareness and activities. Our personal focus of attention is present and operating even in the powerful feelings of annihilation and absolute finality. Paradoxically, that proves the vitality, indestructibility, and undeniability of our personal focus of attention. And what is the main function of focus? to interface between all forms and all streams of all possible realities and creations, to deliver direct first-hand experience to the soul through the fleshing out of dreams, to interpret the wavescape through associations and direct individual creating. If you weren't previously aware of the power and reach of your already existing personal focus of attention, perhaps that veil of forgetting has been involved. The nature of veiling. Everything above corresponds to everything below, and everything below corresponds to everything above to accomplish the miracle of the one thing. Those words come from the most ancient artifact of spiritual wisdom in all the mythology of humankind, the Emerald Tablet. The Emerald Tablet is said to date back to first time, and its teachings weave through all the prominent religious traditions on earth, including the pagan religions. The Emerald Tablet was also considered the guiding text for all alchemists and said to contain the secrets of alchemy. These subjects run so deep and wide that they are a perfect example of what we call a rabbit hole. Parts of the teachings of the Emerald Tablet are woven throughout this material, but if you would like to know more, it's a worthwhile path of study and practice. That first quote has been shortened in recent times to, "As above, so below," and is explained as the principle that the microcosm, the individual human, is a direct reflection of the macrocosm, the universe, and that by studying the nature of the individual human, one can discover the nature of the universe. In other words, if we study how a human life begins, its origins and source, and how the human being develops and evolves, then we have a template for how the universe begins, its origins and source, and how it develops and evolves. These are what are referred to as the mysteries. Hence, the ancient wisdom schools were called the schools of mystery or mystery schools. You may have never heard these things before, and you may also wonder why there is so little knowledge of them now. This is where the notion of veils and veiling comes in. It's not just an individual sort of amnesia we experience concerning our origins and true divine natures. It's humanity-wide, planet-wide, and according to what we're seeing here, this phase of amnesia reaches to the edges of known existence, as above, so below. What are the veils? What is being veiled, and how do the veils operate? These are fantastically good questions that lead to years of discovery and elevated views of the widest scope. These are trailhead questions into the farthest reaches of time and form, trailheads of infinite trails. We're swimming in deep water now. Allow your mind to slow to a smooth and perfect pace of exploration, because paradoxically, the only way to see the swift flow of all-inclusiveness is to slow your perception way, way down. This is where all that letting go you've practiced in life comes into direct play. Let go now of any preconceived notion and just go with the flow. It will seem overwhelming if you fight the flow, so keep dialing your speed down until it no longer feels overwhelming. When you come to a relaxed perspective and images or thought downloads start to come into clear focus, then you're in the flow. You'll feel the vastness of it without feeling daunted by it, and you'll likely feel a sense of your own self expanding, a sense of being giant, light, and quasi-physical. In these moments, these non-physical events, the veils are down and your vision is so clear that you experience a sense of absoluteness, indestructibility, and profoundly deep appreciation and humbleness. These are some of the gifts of paradox. When you expand into your own cosmic vastness, you will feel incredibly open and teachable and astonished. See, the astonishment and the capacity to be astonished is a key aspect of humility. It works in both directions. If you seek to create your own experience of humility, you will inevitably stumble upon your own naturally vast expressions. This is one of the ways that paradox blows off all the doors down all the hidden hallways. This is how paradox thins the veils and reveals new and expanded views to our developing personalities. You may notice that I refer to veils in the plural, when the most common saying is the veil is thinning. When we say the veil, we're speaking of the amnesia, the effect that we experience from our partial seeing and knowing of things. That's why it's so often referred to as the veil of forgetting. But notice now, the amnesia is the effect of the veiling. There are, in fact, multiple veils that shield the developing human person from anything we are not yet equipped to understand or practice. The legends and myths of humankind are filled with references to the number 7. I keep intuiting that there are, in fact, 7 primary veils along the course of our individual metaphysical development. However, at this time, I can only identify 3. The 3 veils I can identify are the veil of duality, the veil of linear time, and the veil of hierarchy. I can't help but sense the edges of the other remaining veils, but they lie outside of my current reach. For our work here, the 3 veils I and you can detect and see coming down in our current time here on Earth are plenty enough to discuss. We'll take them one at a time. The veil of duality. We've already discussed the veil of duality in relation to the death of the childhood or the end of the child way of thinking. We can see even more now that when the veil of duality comes down, paradox is revealed. Remember, duality is the orientation of opposites, only 2 choices, and the either-or mode of choosing. Paradox introduces us directly to the both-and mode of choosing and the expanded realm of infinite choice. It allows you to see how everything exists right along with everything else, that all things are possible, and that there are broader views when you combine seeming opposites into a composite view. These composite views are literally infinite in possible expression, and their combined existence is expressed as mystery. The veil of duality persists until we can comfortably sit with mystery and fish in her waters for the most outrageous combinations of meanings without even blinking. While we're gaining our new sight, we can still see duality clearly, but we start to see tears in the veil, thinning spots and gaps. This is how we naturally condition ourselves to the broader view and acclimate to our own expanded sense of self and reach. Your personal pace shows in your direct experience of these veil-thinning events. Again, you can't force these experiences. You are to notice and reflect on them as they naturally unfold. Asking a paradox question can spark this unfolding, and it can also bring deeply healing views, the deepest, really. For instance, in the world context we're living in now, a great deal of pain and suffering comes from our personal experiences of failure. To fail goes beyond making a mistake. Making a mistake can be just like, whoops, and quickly corrected and learned from. Failure involves deep vestment, dreams and hopes, and the greatest obligations and commitments of our lives. It involves big intentions and represents a great deal of personal effort. We can't fail where we haven't vested some part of ourselves. We can't fail without putting forth some effort in trying new things. If we don't care or feel vestment, then the failure is strictly mechanical. We don't really feel it. If it's true failure, it will come with pain, maybe even anguish. It's one of the hardest things we go through as human types, and it can haunt us with hurt for years, for our whole lives sometimes. My own painful sense of failure caused me to ask what the hell failure is all about. Then it occurred to me, no one in this life is getting through without failing. No one is getting it right on the first try every time. Every parent feels some sense of failure on some level. It just seems to come with the territory. Many of us feel we failed in the relationship arena, either failing to attract a relationship or failing to have a good one, or the relationship itself failing despite the most tremendous efforts and love. Bugger! Even babies experience failure. Then I had the paradoxical thought. What if, in order to succeed, you had to fail? What if to never fail was to fail? What if in order to win, you had to lose? This may sound screwy. It should. If it doesn't have that screwy feeling at first, it's not usually a paradox. Allow me to expand. When we unpack this paradox, we see for a fact that the experience of failure for humans is usual and appears to be universal. We all experience it. Seeing as how we all experience it, it could be an indicator that part of our purpose as humans is to know what it's like to fail. If we're going to experience the full range of human emotion and context, then it only makes sense that failure is on the list. We come here, in part, to fail. When we know that part of our purpose, part of our mission is to experience firsthand our personal sense of failure, then our whole perspective on failure transforms. In this light, our creations of personal failure become a collection of gems that point to our humanity. We need only experience the initial pain of the failure, but we need not drag that pain through the rest of our story. When we recover from our failures sufficiently to accept that it's pretty much a done deal, then we can start to shift our orientation to the events and our feelings about them. We can let ourselves know that we've succeeded in having a failure experience. And if the failure feels epic, we can also let ourselves know that our failure quota is met. And we can just have minor fails from here on out, you know, spilt milk kind of stuff. We can consciously allow the humanity that our mistakes earn us to steal on our heart and heal any remaining hurt. And of course, there's the learning part. We learn throughout our lives from our failures. We often change pretty dramatically in their wake. If we manage to not be bitter, if we manage some grace in the situation, then we automatically model that for those around us. Losing with grace is part of how we build our qualities of honor, dignity, class, and character. In fact, it's very cool to gather yourself up in the face of your setbacks, to be kind to yourself in the wake of your losses, and to fail with style and grace. Yep, that's cool. And honestly, we all like being cool. We go through a lot of trouble to fail. We invest a lot of ourselves. We wouldn't go through that much trouble if our soul didn't intend it. In our greatest failures lie some of the most vital self-revelations that we'll ever have. There are certain capacities that we wish to gain to grow our souls, and we would not be able to fully accomplish them without first-hand experiences with failure. Failure is an experience in its own right. We gain so much from our losses, and if we keep that genuine perspective, we'll never feel like a victim of our failures again. We'll feel like a sculptor instead, and use our failures to increase our communication with our soul and to expand our humanity. This effect makes genuine successes out of our genuine failures. There's that alchemy thing again. It's such a pure frequency that It has a foreign, multidimensional, multi-domain reach. When you use paradox intentionally like that, you send a great and vast healing frequency in all directions. The benefits flow freely and merge naturally with all those in their path, like a gentle breeze caressing the cheek or an unsummoned sweetness that comes over us. It feels like a gift. Somewhere, some other version of ourself has transmuted their personal pain, and the healing has cascaded through our own heart, and no one would ever guess that it started with a failure. That, my friends, is a win-win scenario. We all emerge from duality and into paradox at our own pace, but we need not feel afraid or overwhelmed if we know ahead of time that this new view is coming. If we're taught in our early childhood that a magical change will come over our minds, thoughts, and inner vision, that everything will begin to look and feel different to us, and a veil will fall from our mind's eye that reveals how much we weren't seeing before. If we let our little ones know in creative, natural ways that they will not always be the same, and that it's natural to go through big changes and to feel overwhelmed by them, then those changes won't come as quite so much of a shock. They'll still be shocking, but they won't be devastating, and that makes all the difference in the world. The veil of linear time. Wowzers. The veil of linear time coming down is the most psychologically challenging and experientially intense change to navigate. This veil begins to thin after the veil of duality comes down, but the new view of the ever-unfolding, no past, no future, all-powerful present moment perspective of the infinite now is so challenging to wrap your mind around. It's so sci-fi and psychedelic that no other trip can compare, seriously. Our night dreaming helps to condition our mind to this no-time, all-time, non-linear orientation, or else we'd go straight bonkers when this veil comes all the way down. It ain't all the way down, folks, not at this moment's perception, but it's awfully, awfully thin. It's showing itself in funny ways. One of the ways it's happening is through dimensional slippage. That's what I call it. But it's actually so prevalent that it's gained a name in the wider reaches of human communication. It's being called the Mandela Effect. You can research it. There's quite a bit of material on the interwebs about it. The garden variety of dimensional slippage occurs when you go to put on a piece of jewelry and it's missing. You absolutely know it hasn't been moved, but somehow it's not there. You search and search, no luck. Then hours or days later, you pass by the original location and there it is. There's the necklace, right there, plain as day. Another common experience is when you take a road or pathway you've been on hundreds of times, and suddenly one day there's a large building or other structure that couldn't have just popped up overnight. Inevitably, if you ask someone else about it, they'll say, "Oh, that building's been there for like 3 years. Uh-huh. Dimensional slippage. I mean, do you really think those missing socks and bobby pins and paper clips and car keys are just piled up in this dimension somewhere? Isn't it possible that these little things are like our introduction to simultaneous multi-dimension existence? According to the as above, so below model, we can see that human beings generally learn by starting off with the simplest, easiest to reach steps. Then after some exposure to the initial steps, new pathways emerge that expose even grander and more far-reaching steps. If we use this model, we can see that it's entirely possible that the endless streams of small missing items, or small appearing items, is our sort of introduction to the overlapping nature of individual dimensions of existence. As paradox would have it, the individual dimensions are distinctly unique without being utterly discrete or isolated. In other words, our dimensions of reality can be experienced as an individual and as a collective at the same time. This really is happening all the time, of course. In the simplest terms, we call it sharing. I can share my attention, my awareness, my focus, my love, myself with you, and neither you nor I are diminished by it. Our unique energy pattern is always enhanced by association and contact with other patterns. We do all sorts of sharing, sharing air and atoms, sharing meanings and misunderstandings, sharing in order and in chaos, sharing the storyline of Earth, Gaia, Sophia, in the timeline of the 21st century BC, in the context of planetary transformation. We have caught a ride on a whole system of many lives and massive reach in the grand event of coming of age. We are in the very midst of coming of age individually and as a whole. As this event progresses, you'll notice the dimensional slippage happening more frequently and in grandiose ways, as in the case of the Mandela effect. There are whole groups of people who absolutely experienced, who swear Nelson Mandela died in the 80s in prison. They even recall the funeral and the news reports. There's a whole other group of people who live in the dimension where Mandela died in 2013, a free man in Johannesburg. Hence, the dimensional slippage is being nicknamed the Mandela effect. You will have increasing experiences of this nature, where minor and major details of history as you actually remember it are thrown into a mix of alternate histories. Don't be surprised when family members and friends remember things in a very different way than you, even big things. Be ready to be surprised when you discover things that are so eventful that you have no idea how that could have happened without you knowing. Other phenomena you'll notice are wild synchronicities and meta deja vu. Both are multiple simultaneous doses of their usual experiential weirdness. Wild synchronicities occur when more than two odd factors line up. I'm talking 3 to 6 factors lining up within minutes or hours, so that it's like you're in a stream of connection and magic. It makes you feel woozy and pleasantly stunned. It's a bit unnerving and strangely reassuring at the same instant. There's also a shared synchronicity. When you're with other people and one or more of you experience the same point of single synchronicity, it's a kind of spontaneous, simultaneous group shared realization. Yeah, it's very fucking weird and fun. Weird when it happens. Then there's the multiple deja vus. Seriously, multiple times a day and every day for strings of days at a time. It feels like someone has a remote to your perception and is hitting the slow-mo button off and on all day, like a bizarre dance your soul's leading you in throughout your normal day. Normal, 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 deja vu. Normal, 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 deja vu. Sort of normal, deja vu, deja vu, shuffle ball change. And that can be just the first half of the day. Lordy, it is fun though, and a bit sad when it dissipates. The other multiple is similar to the multi-person synchronicity, only it's with deja vu instead. When you and your buddies are chilling, and one of you says, "Whoa guys, I'm having a deja vu." And you're already having one at the same time. So weird. It makes you look around the room as if some invisible person has just played some mad trick on you. Gives you the chills. It's natural to feel disconcerted at these times, to feel a bit crazy, and to question things that seem unquestionable. Loosen up a little. Remain calm, and let yourself know these are the early markers that the veil of linear time is thinning. It won't feel as scary when you look at it this way. eventually, meaning after a certain saturation point of events, the veil of linear time will come all the way down. Can you guess what that means? It means the end of death as we know it. It means the end of separation by time. It is the grand reunion that's at the core of all our longing hearts, of centuries of a sort of waiting in the darkness for the light to shine. Prepare yourself for that light by seeing that it actually comes from the energy of all that longing and all that waiting. Redemption. In all our unmet needs, in all our failed dreams and dashed hopes and insufferable losses, nothing, nothing has ever been wasted. Nothing. Hope cannot be wasted. Effort cannot be wasted. Our dreams and our love and our works have all been of real substance, and though the energy of our efforts may have gotten redirected into lost scenarios, it can never really be lost. If you had hope that resulted in disappointment, that hope remains in a sort of hope storage, still unused. If you've had tons of dashed hopes, then you have what amounts to a giant reserve of unused hope. That hope is at your direct command because you made it. You created that hope with your own heart, mind, and energy, and the feeling power of that creation can never be destroyed. As the veil of time crumbles, you'll have more and more access to all the feelings and intentions and efforts you made that never came to fruition. What does this mean? It means that you have a giant pool of hope that you can splash on daily and spread around and share generously because now you know nothing is ever wasted. And in knowing nothing is ever wasted, you can freely hope with no fear of disappointment. I think if we check in the collective coffers of our human experience, we'll see that our disappointment vault is filled to overflowing. We've experienced way more disappointment than we needed, and that makes us greedy in a weird way. So enough. We can never do another drop of disappointment, and we'll still have enough for worlds on end. And that is good news. To quote Nadia Khalil Bradley, we're here to grow each other's souls. And we are doing an incredible and awesome work. Our souls have expanded in reach whenever we have been in mutual contact, in love and in conflict, in birth and murder, in war and peace, in our most minuscule beginning, through our early development, and now as we come of age together. Together we will witness the ending of time. We'll experience the rarefied and mysterious event of cosmic time and enter a season of mass reunion, a season of mass shared realizations and newness, a season of remembering and redemption. In the time of no time, we'll have instant access to each other in any context. We'll come to know our many other incarnations through story and the deeper shared memory of our cosmic being. Since all timelines will be accessible from where we sit, it will be the ending of the separateness and hollow finality we've experienced with physical death. We don't have to worry about how we're going to do this. It will just be how it happens. It's already happening. If you have the ears to hear it and the eyes to see it, it's pretty obvious. We won't be conquering death so much as moving into a more expanded meaning of it. In the context of timelines, it will mean being alive and dead at the same time. Some people think that's hard to grasp, but again, it has always been the nature of physical expression to be part dead and part alive. The most common example is of a tree. Parts of the tree are dead and parts are living. The most fascinating example, though, is in that of a developing human embryo. I learned from listening to Terence McKenna that an embryo isn't just a glob of cell structures that keeps being added upon. Nope. Old cells die off so that new formations can take the place of the ones that have already fleshed out as far as they can. At certain saturation points, the cells of the developing embryo are completely replaced as it transforms through different fetal stages. So, the death of the old cells actually drives the emergence of the new ones. And of course, every 7 years, all of our physical cells are replaced due to the ongoing die-off of trillions of cells and the forming of new ones. We don't shed once every 7 years, though. We're continuously shedding cells, constantly dying and being born physically. We're always somewhat dead and somewhat alive at the same time, but it's all life. When you start to notice that we as a group of beings are progressively unfolding our immortal nature, then you'll naturally start to feel your immortal self and what comes with that. Listen to the whisperings of your soul. Allow yourself to be guided into mystery by the immortal expressions of your individualized self. Allow yourself to be more. Allow yourself the realizations that simply await your noticing, like gifts at your feet. Just allow and notice and see what the powerful force of your focus can bring to you in your immortal reach. Allow the presence of the infinite and the eternal. You've already developed to that degree, or else you wouldn't be hearing this. The veil of outside authority. One of the thinnest yet most resistant fucking things you'll ever witness in human development is the veil of outside authority. Absolutely incredible how something so invisible and obvious can be so intractable. By outside authority, I mean any idea that God or any other entity, principle, or process has ultimate dominion or rule over you. Included in this context is the state of perfect balance and equanimity, the state of no hierarchical order at all, no higher or lower, no lesser value or greater value, no comparison in importance, stature, or status. Put another way, what lies beyond the veil of outside authority is the autonomous, sovereign, self-authored, self-created, self-generating life. You are the only living authority on you. In your expanded reality, you are your own authority. As the ever-centered, central character of the ever-unfolding story of you, as the one and only you of you, never-before-individual expression of your soul, you are indeed the boss of your own self. This notion of outside authority sets up one of the most contradictory, entangled, internal wrestling matches we ever experience. Hell, by the time we're two, we know how to say no really well. And when we're four and you tell us no, we say things like, I hate you and you're not the boss of me. I mean, we know from the beginning that we're our own person and our own boss. But we're born into that culture thing, and we're small and severely dependent on parents or other large humans to keep us alive and fairly unmolested. These things come with a natural outside authority. If we want to live, we must keep the rules handed down by the elders. In the linear, dualistic realms of activity, there are obvious hierarchies in the animal and insect world. There are leaders and rules and relationship dynamics that are like games everyone acknowledges and has to play. There's moral authorities and judicial authorities and authoritative frameworks like science, law, politics, institutionalized, bureaucratic, multi-branch systems of authority. It's like a department store of authority that we ran wild in. Now we've charged way more than we can pay. We've taken on so much outside authority that it's smothering us. A time of reckoning is at hand. What do? We just own it. and dial it back. Own our crazy, over-the-top, exaggerated sense of outside authority. We're our own authority now. We'll clean up our messes and correct our courses in our own way, at our own pace, and according to our own treasured and preferred meanings, thank you. And then, just live our lives. There's no debt to pay. When we thought we were running up debt, we were really running a multi-deck obstacle course, and yeah, we have gotten a bit grabby at times, but it was a different context, and we were caught dead in the center of the authority paradox. People with seeming authority over us telling us we've got to be our own authority. It's tricky. Hence the inner and outer struggles for authority, status, dominion, power, and importance. It's part of the warrior's battle, and it's hilariously serious. It's so serious and determines so much in your life, but the internal struggles can be pretty comedic at times. Good time to use your sense of humor and flexibility. Lean into your autonomy and waffle back and forth a bit. Be dependable, but not so reliable that you get pigeonholed. Leave some room for mystery. After all, anything can come out of mystery, making mystery the only ultimate authority. And not even mystery knows all of her contents, meaning ultimately, there is no authority. Anarchy. Don't be scared of anarchy. It just means no governing body of people. It doesn't mean there's no agreements or compromises or cooperative endeavors. Part of the veil of outer authority coming down is evident in the failed governments that dot the globe at this time. People are leaving the ranks of organized religion in huge waves, and people are also starting to champion their own physical, psychological, and spiritual health. The old social structures have been crumbling for some time. The more you have to prop up a system through enforcement tactics, the more lame and unsustainable it shows that system to be. Natural expansion will always obsolete any structure or framework that served its purpose and is no longer engaged. When we learn how to ride alone, the training wheels come off and they stay off. That natural progression shows itself in so, so many aspects of our lives and stories. As human parents, we watch our precious younglings mature and grow away from our command while being sheltered by that command at the same time. Eventually, our younglings grow out of the need for our shelter and construct their own customized realities, and then invite us in. In our initial tours of their newly formed realms, we see bits of our own flair and that of other genetic connections, and we also get to see what they've created on their own, what they worked out, and how they made it happen. It's such a beautiful design. It really is. We miss the beauty of all that outside, ready-made, structured authority on how to be a human being when we overindulge our natural sense of defiance. Defiance is necessary, or else you'd never experiment when your adventure takes you outside the bounds of your parents' set limits. A certain amount of defiance is necessary to break old patterns and start to create your own gig. However, you can get caught in an over-exaggerated sense of defiance and overindulge it till it becomes an addictive pattern. Defiance definitely has a rush to it, and some people just crave that rush. Sometimes the defiance is combined with some other addiction, like substance abuse. It's a double trap, a doubled-up challenge when a person's addicted to a substance and to defiance at the same time. It's a shitstorm, really. So you have to be discerning with defiance and use it for your integrity's sake, not for entertainment. If you overindulge an exaggerated sense of defiance, next thing you know, you'll be 36 and still operating like a teenager. Not attractive. Acting defiantly always means that there's some sort of outside authority to act against. This is another trap to avoid, the overindulgence of defiance. It traps you in the victim blame state. Seriously, avoid that shit. Once defiance has served its actual function, which is to enable you to break through the bonds of the outside authority structures of how life should be pursued, then it really serves no purpose after that. On the other side of healthy defiance lies the beginnings of autonomous life, full accountability for our lives, and the entrance into our own divine nature. When we're fully accountable for our own lives, we take our place at the elders' table, and all are equal there. The veils serve to protect a developing human being until they reach a degree of expansion that pushes beyond the veils. In this way, the veils are signals that alert us to our own changing self. When a veil starts to thin and tear and you experience bursts of the more expanded view, that's a sign of your spiritual development. As you mature, the veil thins more and more. Until the veils are all the way down, you find yourself in transition states, straddling two paradigms, and showing ever-increasing characteristics of the new views. During these transition times, it gets pretty messy because you express in a waffling manner between your old self and the new self that's emerging. You experience split decisions and confusion and bouts of hypocrisy. Oh, hypocrisy. It's pretty Jekyll and Hyde, but it's temporary. As you continue to expand, you experience patches of the new view instead of just bursts. Then the patches begin to stretch out into spans of widening experience. And then the next thing you know, you're completely different in ways you could have never imagined. So the veils are protectors, boundary setters, and signals of change in the meta realms. As we human beings are coming of age together in this realm, there's a palpable energy swirling all around. And if you check your own insights, you'll easily see that we indeed live in very exciting times. Indeed. Paradox is prevention. You can use paradox anytime you need it to get unstuck. A genuine paradoxical view of your current scenarios will unstick you every time. Getting unstuck from overwhelming or painful perspectives is the best prevention there is. By now, I would think that you are paying better attention to your focus and what you're focusing on. And that's the whole aim right there. As we can see through reflection, the power of just noticing is potent and highly underestimated in its influence to invoke change. Take notice of your focus. Explore decisions before committing to them when possible. And learn to shift on the fly when exploring and considering are not much of an option. Continually observe your decision-making, your shifting and creating, and the reflection of your soul shining through all those actions. And be of good cheer because growing up means that suffering and sadness come to an end for you as an individual. You'll still have challenges, but they will never again involve the suffering, loss, and sadness you've navigated in your adolescent phase of life. Your experiences with suffering, loss, and sadness have refined, shaped, and transformed your personality, and you break through to new ways of being, new forms of challenge. These new ways do not require suffering. They do not require loss. Besides which, don't we all have enough suffering and loss under our belt? At some point, it does end. So yeah, be excited and relieved. Feel your surfer nature as its pull becomes more noticeable in your life and allow yourself the incredible experience of a deepening two-way communication with your soul. A short list. You are simultaneously occupying pasts, and futures. I am both one and many. The unchangeable is always changing. Boundaries are how we share separateness. In its barest expression, a lie is a true lie. To find yourself, you have to lose yourself. No limits is a limit. We are physical and non-physical, ignorant and brilliant, large and small, complex and simple, manifest and unmanifest, disappearing and appearing, rough and smooth, vulnerable and indestructible, temporarily and eternally, here, there, everywhere, and nowhere. So collect your ironies and bask in your paradoxical states. Stretch out in your new expanse. Relax into the emerging views and lean into your surfer ways, your surfer thoughts, and your surfer nature. Soon enough, our triumphant laughter will thunder through the heavens. Our collective sighs will whisper through the eons, and the whole universe will witness and welcome us home to our fully experienced self. Listen closely, and you can hear it already streaming in from far-off horizons. Welcome. Welcome home. Welcome home. Watch Max Trinity's Metaphysics for Suicide Prevention, Part 9, The Surfer Task. Much love and peace to you, my friends.